Sure, glad you're here today. If you have your phones, your iPads, or you just simply want to listen, I'm going to turn over to the Gospel of Luke, Matthew, Mark, Luke. And Luke was a physician. He was a traveling companion of Paul. Actually, he recorded and did so much. If you read it from a historical standpoint, you'll get so much information, as well as it being inspired by God. But I want to read to you here Luke 10 and verse 38 through 42. Now it happened as they went that he entered a certain village, and a certain woman named Martha welcomed him into her house. And she had a sister called Mary who sat at Jesus' feet and heard his word. Martha was, and I'll say it three times, Martha was a good Christian who loved Jesus, again, who welcomed Jesus into her home, but Martha was distracted. Martha was distracted with much serving or much of something. Every one of us have much in our lives, and that's what makes us distracted. She approached him and said, "Lord, do you not care that my sister has left me to serve alone? Therefore, tell her to help me." Because in your distraction can come frustration. He goes on, he says, and Jesus answered and said to her, "Martha, Martha, you are worried and troubled about many things. But this one thing is needed, and Mary has chosen that good part which will not be taken away from her." I just simply want to title this message, Fatal Attractions. Fatal Attractions. I want to talk about the things that want to steal from our lives, the things that want to stop our lives, and the things that want to seduce our lives from the purpose of God in our life. You know, a few years ago, I was mountain biking down a hill. And I was really enjoying it. And then off to my right, probably about a quarter of a mile away, I saw another descending trail that I had never been on before. And so what I basically was doing was going downhill, and then I'd look over here and I'd go downhill and look down here to try to figure out how to get to that one and where it was coming from. The next thing I know, I came around a bend, I looked one more time, and boom, I hit a big boulder, and I somersault, I Superman, and I landed up breaking two ribs, and boy, did I learn my lesson. It's amazing how when you take your eyes off of something, you can become easily distracted, and sometimes it doesn't turn out the way that you'd like it to turn out. Because distractions are to take your eyes off of things that are important and put your eyes on things that are less important. Distraction draws your attention to wrong stuff rather than right stuff. And distraction is a diversion in your life. It's an interruption and an interference that the enemy wants to bring in your life so that you will not live out the purpose of God. Now, let me define the purpose of God real quick to you. The purpose of God is hooked up to the people God's called you to the places God's called you to the plan that God's called you to. So if you want to understand what purpose is connected to people, purpose is connected to a place, a location, and a purpose is connected to a plan. And it's amazing how many people don't stick with people, how many people don't stay in the same place, and how many people are moving on to this and moving on to that, and they're missing the purpose of God. How does that happen? It happens because of distractions. Do you know that an athlete's success is the fact that he stays focused and does not get distracted? It could be detriment to the team or winning or losing based upon a distraction. Do you know the difference between a student graduating and a student dropping out or failing is the ability to stay focused and not get distracted in their lives? How many of you know many accidents have happened and people have not arrived on their destination in a car because they got distracted either by texting or getting something from the back or some noise, and it ends up in an accident? So it is in a Christian's life. How many Christians have gotten distracted? And because of that, they never walked in the fulfillment of God, the purpose of God. They never matured. They never bore fruit. They were never growing. It was kind of a stop and go and hesitation in their lives, all because of distractions that are in their lives. This great scripture also says this in Matthew 14. Peter answered him and said, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." So he said, come. And when Peter had come down out of the boat, he walked on the water to go to Jesus. Wow. First person to ever do that besides Jesus. But when he saw, he was doing so good. He was walking on the water. He was walking in the impossible. He was enjoying Jesus' benefits and blessings. But when he began to see the wind boisterous, he was afraid and he began to sink and he cried out, Lord, save me. And Jesus saved him. See, I want you to recognize that Peter was doing so well walking in the will of God, walking toward Jesus, whatever way you want to define it. But he began to sink. Why? Because he was distracted. He took his eyes off of Jesus and he began to look to the circumstances and the situation that brought fear into his life, that threatened, and you know the end. Bloop, 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 bloop. He sank. And there's so many people that take their eyes off of Jesus and what Jesus promised and what Jesus said. He said, you can walk. That's all. He didn't say you can sink. He said, you can walk. But the circumstances of our lives become much more of a dominant force or voice or noise or sound in our lives that we get distracted and we begin to sink. You know, when I was studying for this message this week, I was in Albuquerque, New Mexico. So I was doing some research on the internet on my iPad and was looking up some things. And the next thing I know, I had this Amazon advertisement come on the screen. They just come up randomly. How many of you know what I'm talking about? I wish I could get them out, but they come up randomly. And they said, you are an instant winner and you can win on Amazon. And the wheel began to spin. And so I was fascinated by the wheel. So I pressed it. And it said, boom, I won $1,000 from Amazon. And it just said, to continue, press this. And I pressed continued. And it just said, answer a few questions. And 5 minutes later, I'm no closer to my $1,000. And I'm further away from my message. I'm so distracted. I don't know about you. I hate flies in my house. Flies. Flies are a distraction. And I'm on a mission to eradicate flies from my house. I went to the Bass Pro Shop the other day and I bought this fly zapper. It electrocutes them. It's like a tennis racket and you hit it and it goes bzzz and it's fascinating. It's a dude thing. Dudes would love it. Wives, for Christmas, go buy your husband a fly zapper. It only costs like $7, but man, he'll be awesome. It'll keep him distracted from you for a long time. Go play with your fly zapper. Go over there. Stop looking at me that way. No. Go. Right over your head, but right along, moving right along. The next thing you know, I'm trying to cook, I'm trying to interact, I'm trying to watch TV. I get up and I'm chasing all the flies all over my house, trying to zap them until I'm saying, Diego, let it go. He'll come back around, he'll die like in how long they live, 24 hours or whatever? But it's amazing how easily we can become distracted. I want to turn over now to the book of Nehemiah. And I want to just share some things from Nehemiah's life. Nehemiah could have been distracted, but he refused to be distracted. Now, if you don't know much about the book of Nehemiah or the person of Nehemiah, he was just simply a Jewish man. He was living in a faraway city, and he was a cupbearer to the king, which means he tested what the king drank in case he was poisoned. And so he heard about his city that he came from, where his forefathers came from, a city in Jerusalem. And he had heard that their walls of defense that protected them had been down for a long time. So he asked permission from the king, and he went on over there, and he canvassed. He prayed first, that's important. And then he went over there and he canvassed what it would take, how much money, how much people, how he could rebuild these walls. And so amazingly, I'll say just up front, in 52 days, a man that has no experience, he's just a cupbearer, is able to raise walls that have been down for a long time. But I want to just show you just a few verses, and you're going to have to stay with me just so that I could drive this point that it wasn't easy. He had to overcome distractions. Nehemiah 2 and verse number 19. So they said to me, let us rise and build. And they set their hands to do a good work. But when Sanballat the Horite and Tobiah the Amorite, officials, and Geshem the Arab, remember this names, we'll hear them again, Sanballat, Tobiah, and Geshem, heard that we were rebuilding the walls, they laughed at us and despised us and said, "What is this thing that you are doing? Will you rebel against the king?" They misinterpreted what this was all about. Because whenever you're doing something righteous and you're doing something from God, it will always stir something up. You're never doing anything good for God unless you're stirring up something. So you go over to chapter 4, you're not going to make everyone happy, and you got to be content with that. To follow Christ is not going to make people happy. And so it goes on to chapter 4, and it says, "Now, but it so happened when Sanballat heard that we were rebuilding the walls," instead of this guy saying, "Wow, I'm going to enjoy the benefits of walls to protect us and defend us," it makes him mad. He's jealous. He's full of envy, maybe thinking, "Why didn't I do it?" So it says, he began to be furious, very indignant, and mock the Jews. And he spoke before his brethren in the army of Samaria and said, "What are these feeble Jews doing?" Now he's trash talking. "You no good, you little old nothing. Who do you think you are?" How many of you know what trash talk sounds like? None of you know. Okay, moving right along. Verse number 3. Now Tobiah the Amorite was beside himself. He was upset too. And he said, "Whatever they build, if even a fox goes on it, it will break down the stone wall." Man, negativity amplified. A feather, a wind will blow and it'll knock it down. It goes on and it says in verse number 6, "So we built the wall. The entire wall was joined together up to half of its heights, for the people had a mind to work. Now it happened when Sanballat and Tobiah, the Arab, and the Amorite, and the Ashdodite heard that the walls of Jerusalem were being restored and the gaps were beginning to be closed, that he became very angry, and all of them conspired together to come attack Jerusalem and create confusion." And then it goes on and says, "Nevertheless, we prayed." Let's go over to chapter 6 now. "Now it happened when Sanballat, Tobiah, and Geshem, the Arab, and the rest of our enemies," whenever you do something great from God, enemies, you will attract enemies. "And it says, heard it that I had rebuilt the wall and that there were no breaks left in it, though at that time I had not hung the doors in the gates, that Sanballat," they keep coming back. The enemy is relentless. "And Geshem sent to me and saying," come, watch this, they sent a word to him, a letter, a text, an email. "Come, let us meet together among the village in a plain of Ono," but they thought to do me harm. "So I sent message to them saying, I'm going to have a little attitude here. I am doing a great work so that I cannot come down. Why should the work cease and I leave it and go down to you?" Watch this. "But they sent me this message 4 times, relentless, relentless. And I answered them in the same manner." And you could just read on and on and on. But verse number 15 says, "So the wall was finished in the 25th day of Elah, in 52 days. 52 days. Here's just amazing things that happened to Nehemiah, or he wouldn't let happen, and how he had to overcome the distractions. I'm going to give you 10 things today on how to overcome the distractions of your life. Take it from the life of Nehemiah. Number one is this: you need to avoid toxic and unhealthy relationships. Sure recipe for walking out of your purpose and not fulfilling your God-given purpose is that there's always going to be Sanballats out there, and there's always going to be Tobias out there, and there's always going to be Geshens out there that are either one way or another threatened, insecure, or jealous, or naysayers, or negative, and don't want you to succeed in the mission God's called you to. And so I want you to know, many people are distracted by what they said or by what they're doing instead of keeping their eyes on Jesus. So I want you to recognize, we've got to recognize when toxic and unhealthy relationships come into our lives. Because when you and I are distracted, it will always lead to compromise, frustration, exhaustion. When you and I fall to distraction, it will steal and rob your time, your energy, and your focus. Here's what I could tell you. I could predict your future by the people that you hang around. Oftentimes, you will copy, you will emulate, and you will imitate the people that you hang around. So you hang around critical people, you're going to become critical. You hang around complainers, you're going to become a complainer. You hang around judgmental people, you're going to become judgmental. But you hang around positive people and helpful people and encouraging people and people that want to grow and people want to thrive in their relationship. How many of you know what I'm talking about? You hang around women who don't like men, and the next thing you know, you don't like men. I could see that's going over really great in the we movement of abundant living. Say, Pastor, I know. That's just the way I am. I gotta be me. Remember that message? I gotta be me. You hang around men that don't like women, and the next thing you know, you don't want to get married or you don't trust women because they're going to steal your money. See, look at all the women. You tell them, Pastor. I had a friend growing up. His name was Phil. Not this Phil. He was my age, Phil. And as I look back, I couldn't recognize it at that point because I was too young and I was too close to Phil, not only in proximity, but in emotion. But as I look back now, every time I hung around Phil, I got in trouble. Phil introduced me to stealing. Phil introduced me to marijuana. Phil introduced me to driving when I was below the age of 16. Phil introduced me to womanizing. Phil introduced me to a lot of stuff. I could not recognize at that point that he was a toxic, unhealthy relationship. And I'll just tell you, you don't need to know the outcome, but it never turned out good when I hung around Phil. The second thing is that people get distracted with messy clutter in their lives. Messy clutter. Collecting and hoarding and holding on to things that just don't matter. I don't know about you. I function at a higher capacity when things are neat, tidy, and organized. I don't function well when things are broke up, tore up, dirty, lost, stolen. It's amazing how much time can be wasted looking for something that I know I have. But because I didn't put it back or I didn't clean up the mess, I'm looking through all, it's got to be here. It's got to be here somewhere. It's got to be here somewhere. It's amazing how many people can live in a pig's pen of life. And I want you to know, Nehemiah is going to get this job done because he's very, very organized. He has a strategy. He knows how to do it. He recruits the people. He gives them job assignments. He tells them where to be on the wall. He knows how to have a strategy to combat when the enemies come. And amazingly, he's able to accomplish this in 52 days. So I want you to recognize, you and I are distracted if we have no plan for our life, no vision for our lives, no goal, no agenda, no calendar, no budget, no time, no location, and no strategy. We will be distracted. What's your vision for your marriage? What's the vision for your kids? What's the vision and the plan and the strategy for your finances? You will be distracted from reaching your goal. The third word is a word called procrastination. And I love this verse in Ecclesiastes. If I could get a tattoo, I'd tattoo this verse on my arm. It says, if you wait for perfect conditions, you'll get nothing done. Come on. That's a great word. So many people, well, you know what? When I retired, when I get younger, when I feel better, I'll start financially giving when I come out of debt, when I pay off everything. You know, you won't. Because the scripture says, if you're waiting for perfect conditions, you will never get anything done. You got to do it right now in imperfect conditions. So many people are distracted because of procrastination. Nehemiah will not procrastinate. Let's get the job done, no matter what we have to overcome. Procrastination is the mañana syndrome, tomorrow. I want to put everything up. Tomorrow I'll start. Tomorrow I'll stop. Tomorrow I'll go get counseling. Tomorrow I'll get help. Tomorrow I'll help. Tomorrow I'll volunteer. Tomorrow I'll give. It's the mañana syndrome. Mañana means I meant to. I was about to. I was almost going to, but I never did. You know, the latest statistics are this, that there are 6 million people looking for a job. But at the same time, there are 6.4 million jobs available. What does that say? One of the attributes of procrastination is laziness. Now, I'm not blanketing everybody here today. But when you have the means to work but choose not to because you are selective and prideful, then you are a procrastinator, you are lazy. How could you say, I can't find a job when there are 6.4 million jobs available? I'm going to leave it at that. I'm moving on now. In the words of Forrest Gump, that's all I got to say about that. Comparison. Comparison is massive. Comparison is massive to being distracted in our lives. Trying to be like somebody else rather than what God wants for your life. A discontentment. You're not content being single. You're not content being married. You're not content not having children. You're not content with the children. You're not content with what you drive, what you wear. People are just, because you're comparing. You're comparing. Look at how they look. Look at how tall they look. Look at how cute they are. Look at how many Botox treatments they had. Look at their extensions. Look at their nails. How will you ever stay focused on what God's called you to do when you are trying to fit into a role, when you are trying to keep up with the Joneses, when you're trying to live by a title or a classification or follow the culture and the way of the world? There's this classic picture from the last Olympics as Michael Phelps swam in the 200 meter against the South African Chad Lacrosse. Notice this, that Michael Phelps will win the race, but notice where Chad's eyes are. Looking at Michael. Instead of looking forward at his own race, he's more concerned about his competitor or the man next to him. It's a great comparison. I know for many years I didn't walk in the gift that God called me because I would compare myself with other preachers that are on television. And I thought, to be a success, I've got to do that. I got to do that, and I got to do that. The problem was, is I never found out who I was and what I was gifted with. So when I found out that I had a certain personality and I had a certain gift, that wouldn't minister to everybody, and I was okay with that. But I had to be true to myself and not try to be like somebody else because I couldn't keep that up and I couldn't maintain it because every once in a while the real Diego would pop up and I'd have to push him back down. People get in trouble because of trials and tribulation. They get distracted easily because of tough times and difficult times. Because whether you look at it as the enemy attacking you, or whether you look at it as pressure or opposition or obstacles or difficulty or hardships, people easily can become distracted and stop moving forward and abort what God's called them to. Because whenever you do something for God, like Nehemiah, there's going to be Sanballat, Tobias, and Geshems. But he refuses. I don't care how much they mock him, how much they ridicule him. He'll push right past it. And there's some people that don't have no pain tolerance. They give up. They quit. It's too hard. They stop praying. They stop coming to church. They stop loving their wives. Through the difficulties of whatever's going on, because an expectation is not met. So I just want you to recognize trials and tribulations are always going to come, but you still cannot be distracted by those. So in that race that I just referred to, in the 200 meters, in the pre-warm-up room, this South African tried to intimidate Michael by getting in front of him and shadow boxing right in front of him to intimidate him. And if you look at Michael, his head's down, he listens to his music, and he's saying, we'll play the game in the water. I'll leave all my emotions when we get in the water. Now you know why he won. And the enemy will get in front of you and he'll try. Mm-mm. I'm gonna knock you out. He's a trash talker. That's the way the enemy is. Your marriage will never succeed. You'll never own your own property. You'll never own your business. You know, your children are going to grow up a certain way. And I just want you to know you cannot allow the trials. I call them just simply the nails, the wrenches, and the thorns, the roadblocks, the deterrents, and the delays in our lives. Another distraction is holding on to the past. Philippians, a classic verse, and many of you know, but in case you don't know, forgetting those things that are behind us, we reach forward to those things that are in front of us. Philippians 4:13. You got to forget those things. So I have a special guest artist who would like to sing to you her song today. So I want you to listen to the screens today or watch them.
Conceal, don't feel, don't let them know.
Cost me a lot of money to get Princess Elsa to come here and sing for you today. But it's amazing how many people are so distracted because they can't let things go. Holding on to offenses, bitternesses, grudges, unforgiveness, what they said to me, the betrayal of their lives. And Sister Elsa says, you just got to let it go. But greater than Sister Elsa, Jesus said to let it go. You just got to let it go, no matter what it is. Flush it down the toilet. Don't sit there and look at it. I got to be me. People get distracted. People get distracted by uncontrolled emotions. The inability to control your feelings, how you feel. Nehemiah will control his emotions. Was he upset? You better believe it. Was he equally angry? I'm sure he was. Was he irritated? Was he frustrated? Absolutely. But he's got a job to do and he won't lose his focus. He controlled his emotions. And you show me somebody who cannot control their emotions, their moods, their feelings, and I'll show you someone that will not stay on purpose and will easily get distracted. You got to control your emotions. And emotion, I feel like. I don't care what you feel like. That doesn't mean you should do it. Well, I don't feel like. I don't care. Get your blessed assurance up and go do it. It's a responsibility. It's a commitment. It's a problem. Well, I don't feel like things are the same. Well, nothing is the same. So you're going to move out and make a choice and a major decision in your life based upon a feeling? I don't know about you. Feelings, to be honest, are fickle. They're like the wind. They come and they go. And I got to live my life based upon the scriptures. That's why the Bible says I walk by faith and not by sight. That's why the Bible says cast down images, emotions, feelings, and thoughts that wants to exalt itself against the knowledge of God's will. You can't be controlled by your feelings. I feel like having sex out of wedlock. Nope, you can't. Sorry, you're a Christian. Suck it up, big boy. Sorry. Crucify the flesh. That means beat it black and blue. Beat it down. Beat it down. Beat. I don't care what you feel like. I feel like hurting somebody. I feel like cussing at somebody. I feel like quitting. I feel like giving. You can't. When you have a major feeling of dominance, ask God, do I have the permission to feel the way I feel? I dare you. I double dog dare you. The next time you feel like doing something, ask God, do I have the permission to live out this feeling? People are distracted because they concede to temptation. They concede to the temptation. Remember what Sanballat said? Let's meet in Ono. Ono. So you're going to always get in trouble when you go to Ono. Why the heck am I doing here? I know I shouldn't be doing meeting here. He knew that. He's not going to meet an Ono. Ono's trouble. He's not going to concede to the temptation. And you and I will get distracted by temptation of money, lust, materialism, pleasure, arrogance, pride, food, drink, working out too much, being a sportsaholic. You're just addicted to the Lakers, and the next thing you know, you're the Dodgers, and the next thing you know, you're the Kings, and the next thing you know, you're, who'd I forget? The Rams. Can't miss a game, miss church. I'm not saying you can't enjoy sport, but there comes a point when you concede to temptation. You got to know when enough's enough. Time out. You're intruding in my priorities and in my responsibilities. And that's what most people can't do. They can't say that's it, enjoy it, but and have fun with it. But now that's enough now. That's enough now. You know, not too long ago, and I got into this little trend because I have a little bit, if you don't know, a little bit of an obsessive personality to me. I'm very passionate about anything. You think I'm passionate about here. Come with me on a golf course. Come with me to play Monopoly. Come with me to drive a car. I'm passionate about anything I do. I won't do anything unless I'm passionate. So if I do something, I'm very passionate about it. And I want to get it done, and I'll bulldoze, and I'll do whatever I do. So for a minute there, I'm into shoes. I said, man, I like these shoes, these young people wearing shoes. I got to know where they shop. I got to ask them what the native shoes are. So next thing I know, I'm buying a shoe, and then I like this shoe, and I'm buying a shoe, and I'm buying this shoe. And I'm thinking, when am I going to wear all these shoes? So I rose up and said, you can't buy another shoe. You're prohibited to buy another shoe. You're on a timeout, Diego. You can't buy shoes. So I haven't bought a shoe in like 3 months. Now, so what I am doing is I'm smart. I'm going to give away the old ones so that now I can buy some new ones. But all I'm trying to say, you can laugh at my shoes, but let's talk about your donuts. Let's talk about your caffeine. Can't have one cup of coffee there. You can't just have one donut. There you go. You got to know when enough's enough and say no to it. I want you to know people can easily become distracted when they're obsessed with social media. Looking at that phone all the time, emails, Facebook, Twitter, Snapchat, whatever it is, internet, Instagram, you eat with it, you drive with it, you sleep with it, you bathe with it, and you go to the bathroom with it. You twitch every time there's a ding, a zing, a ring, a buzz. You can be easily distracted by getting anything done. Believe me, there's a difference between productivity and busyness. You can be busy all day long and do nothing. There's a place for it. We enjoy the benefits and the fruit of it. But there's enough to say, you know, it's time to sleep right now. Let me put this object that controls me in another room so I don't hear zzz and ding. I'm going to the bathroom. Stay outside of the bathroom. I need a few moments of peace, or for some of you, much longer. Have you ever looked around when you're driving a car and seen how many people are driving a car texting all the time? So we can easily become distracted. And the last thing, and I'm done and you've been great, is this. You know, before I do that, I want to give you a thought here today. I was thinking about a couple things. And that when criminals or a thief wants to take an advantage of you, he has to create a diversion or a distraction. Look over here, and then he comes around and he robs from you. He has a friend, look over here, to get your attention. It's the way the enemy is, to create a diversion, and he wants to create a diversion in your life. But I thought through the 33 years of preaching, and I thought to myself, you know what? I've had to preach through a lot of distractions. Here are my distractions that I've had to preach through. People sleeping, people texting, people leaving while I'm preaching. I've had to preach through people not saying anything, quiet. And I have a difficulty when it's too quiet. I have had to preach when no one is saying nothing. I've had to preach through noise on the backstage. You can't hear, but I can. One time I heard vacuuming going on while I was preaching. And I'm like this, looking at Pastor. I've had to preach through them vacuuming. I've had to preach through. One time, somebody was wearing boxing gloves the whole time I was in the front. Somehow he was in the front row with boxing gloves, and I had to keep preaching. I've had to preach with people's phones going off, and that funny part is what their voice tone is when it goes off. Because some people have really, really funny answering things when it goes off. One was a play that funky music, white boy. Play. I feel like I say, everybody, let's just sing along together. Play that funk. The things that I've had to deal with when preaching, all kinds of issues. One other time, which was, it's happened several times. It's different now, but before, ladies back in the day used to wear skirts. They don't really wear skirts like they used to, but when they came to church, they'd wear skirts. And I'd always have a lady sit in the front row who had a short skirt. How does a brother man preach Jesus? So, to not concede to temptation, Pastor Diego said, I will not visit that side of the church today, and I will preach to this side of the church. How y'all doing today? Looking good, feeling good. The last word is this. How to overcome distractions is this. When you and I don't passionately pursue God every day in our lives, we will be distracted. Now listen, I'm just not talking about believing in God. I'm just not talking about knowing God, nor am I talking about loving God, because that would be most of us. I'm talking about a whole nother level of degree of relationship with Jesus Christ, where I want His will, His ways, and His word in my life. In every decision, in every choice, I want God's blessing. I love the Lord with all my heart, all my soul, and all my body in my life. I put God first in every choice and every decision. I want God's best, I want God's more, and I want God's extra in my life, and I'm willing to give God that. And last of all, Nehemiah was not distracted because he had discernment. He knew the plans of the enemy, therefore he could divert them. You and I will always be distracted if we do not have discernment. I got to know what the plan of the enemy is. I got to know what the plan of God is for my life. In the early 1800s, there was a young man who was looking for a job as a telegraph operator for Morse code back then. Remember, they didn't have phones and walkie-talkies and ways to communicate, so they used to use for long distance telegraph and Morse code. So he went to the station or the company, and there were a bunch of people as he walked through the door lined up already pre-there waiting for their interview. And when he walked in, the noise was overwhelming of telegraph operators and Morse code going on. But he noticed a sign, and the sign said this. If you're looking for the job, then fill out the sign said, fill out the application and sit down and wait till you are called to pass through the other door. And that's what all the other people were doing. So he filled out his application, and once upon filling out the application, he walked through that door. And everybody was shocked. Didn't he read it? Why is he going in? 10 minutes later, the boss comes out and he looks and says, the job's yours. All you people could go home. I hired him. They said, that's not fair. He didn't obey the rules. What's going on? And they said, if you would have paid attention to the Morse code said this, if you understand this message, then come right in to the office. The job is yours. You've got to be able to discern the noises out there and the voices out there and the sounds out there, because there's a lot of them today that are going to persuade you to go one way or the other way. You've got to be able to discern the voice of Jesus, the purpose of God for my life, rather than the sounds leading me somewhere else. Father, I thank you for the message today, and I pray that it resonates in our hearts. I pray, Lord, that we are not distracted. Distracted by the enemy, distracted by the ways of this world, the culture of this world, God. What they are saying, it's like Isaiah, we call evil good and good evil, God. Our society is so upside down. We ought to be the most stable people as Christ followers, and we ought to be shining as a light in this very hour, God. That's what you need from us. We're governed by your word, not our feelings. And most people in this world are governed by their feelings, and they're very outspoken about their feelings. So God, help us to not be disfocused on the purpose that you've called us to. In Jesus' name, amen.